This is called Circle Machine. And what's going to happen is one person will start with a motion and gesture. Okay, and we'll have some of the circle do... All right, stop. Seeing the sign changing. So we're going to do, like, with a beat. So it's going to be, boo, beat, rest. Boo, rest.
Boo, rest. Can we all, but not all my beats?
Boo.
Yes.
Boo. And then we're going to add something after the boo, during that rest time. And then it's going to be, boo, something else, rest. Okay? Wait, no.
Co-creation, the terms
of LARP, I would see it as kind of what sets LARP apart as its own sort of art form, because it is this creative piece that contains written and theatrical elements that is not performance in a true sense, where everyone is bringing their own feelings and interpretations into the game space, and instead of interpretations being valid after viewing a piece of art, all the interpretations exist within the piece of art at once, and that is the creation itself.
My name is Johanna Koljonen Ojok, and I'm the CEO of Participation Design Agency. I'm a game designer and a LARP theorist as well. Everything everyone says is obviously true, so I'm just going to add another aspect, which is that obviously all kinds of art are co-creative. Theater people can get really offended if you say that theater is less co-creative than art. It's clearly less co-creative than art. because to them, there isn't, like, without the audience, there is nothing. And of course, the same way with, like, when we interpret cinema or read a novel or something, of course, it's co-creative. So I find it very helpful to think about this as scales, and especially in design practice, also on a very practical level, it's good to realize that the level of co-creation of different aspects of all art is are important tools in your design toolkit. So we have this metaphorical tool that we call the mixing desk of LARP, where you're working with faders like this. And some of the very common faders that we often talk about is, for instance, character creation responsibility. Is it the people who design the LARP who are responsible for designing the characters, or is it the players who do it completely freely? And those are the extremes. And in most kinds of LARP design, whichever faders you're looking at, the extremes almost never happen. It's always somewhere in between. So other faders that you could imagine where you have to make design choices about the degree of co-creation would be things like the cultures of the fiction. Am I going to dictate it, or will the participants develop it together? But it can also be things like you were saying about, like, they have a real, like, interaction where story outcomes, for instance, you can say, well, we're not going to have, in order to talk quite often, we don't have game masters, for instance. We don't have a storyteller who arbitrates the outcome. We let the participants have that responsibility. And of course, you can also do it on the design level. You can also let the participants redesign the piece as it's progressing. That makes me supremely uncomfortable. co-creation is also a series of design choices that you make.
So for the rest of this, I have a couple questions that I'm going to ask. If you have a question or a statement or pushback or want to add to the conversation, I just ask that you just give me a sign so that I can moderate just who's talking at once. We're going to talk over each other. I guess the one thing that I do want to know before we open up larger is, in the work that you are doing, or the work that you plan to do, or the work that you love to do, how is co-creation a part of that, and how are you using that or facilitating it?
So I don't do a lot of practical things, since I just write papers a lot.
Tell me about that, though.
So what we've been writing about more recently is, and I don't know if this is super cool, been looking at lots of marketing literature that's been talking about co-creation and marketing for lots and lots of years. And so we've been kind of expanding out from how can we co-create with our participants before they actually arrive at the LARP, for example, and how can we continue to co-create with them after they leave to kind of continue that experience. We've also been looking at, just to touch on what Ron said with, like, faders, like, do we have, is high co-creation, is more always better, I guess, that aspect. Maybe it's not, right? Maybe depending on our participants more isn't always better. But just looking at that, that's the idea.
Do you have, like, a personal feeling one way or the other, or because you've been researching it intellectually, but what is your take, I guess?
I'm just co-creation.
Yeah, and is more better? Is
I don't think more is always better. I think it depends on the situation. For example, if you went to a restaurant, right, and it was always totally co-creative, and they said, you just do whatever you want. It's like, well, I could have done that in my own dad kitchen. So there are situations where you want it to be a little bit more structured from maybe one end or another. But I think that co-creation in general is what people want, right? People want to be able to act in They want to be able to do things. They want to be able to personalize or customize or have this like feeling of freedom in the experiences that they're engaging in. I also think that there's an issue of like self-relevance, right? If we're allowing people to co-create, then their experience is going to be much more self-relevant and much more personal and intimate to them than it would be if I created it for them. Yes, I'm very pro-co-creation.
I guess we're in order. I'll talk about Event Horizon because Jeff can talk about like, our experience. But so in Event Horizon, we do less co-creation than I've done with Wayfinder experience. But what we do is we custom write characters to the individual person after getting their survey and input. But also between that point and the game, we allow for them to make changes and we purposefully put in questions in the character sheet and room for them to build things in. So that's not very radical type of co-creation. I think that is something that a way that certain types of writers use character sheets. And I'm going to come back to the character sheet thing in just a second. The other thing that we do that is more co-creative that we want to do more is getting people to help shape the world that they're participating in, because it's one sci-fi universe. What happens at each game affects the future in a way that like we determine, but we take in everything that has happened and we try to give that importance. We want to allow players to say, at this point in time, in this big galaxy, I bet there's going to be this thing, or I want to create this like mutant pet that's going to be on this planet, and we're going to like, we actually might do this now, design and do some drawings for these type of bespoke mutant pets that people would have on this elite, rich, mutating planet. We want to look for opportunities to build community and interest in the game by having people start making cultures. And part of that means that we need to give room for the players to come in and make things, which I'll come back to the character sheet thing, which is right now, currently, I'm kind of on a kick of like doing less with character sheets. And kind of like, now I like want to fight against character sheets. I'll fight against something else later. But character sheets, in some ways that I've written LARPs, that I see other people write LARPs, it's like, I'm gonna give the person everything they need to know to play the game. And then I'm gonna give them this really, really cool character that is super awesome, and they're gonna love it, and they're gonna come to game, and they're gonna play it like that, and have a really fun time. I've seen people have engaged just as deeply and immersively with games where they did not get a character sheet. They got nothing special, but characters were made with workshopping beforehand, and that is extremely collaborative and co-creative. Designing your game only with character sheets does not necessarily mean that it is fully designed or designed well. I don't think in a lot of games you need them at all. giving players opportunity to fully have independence over their, or to have a lot of independence over their characters can be great. And obviously in Event Horizon we do character sheets because it's part of the event that we are selling as a company, is that like, we're going to make you this thing that is just for you. I want to push people to make character sheets and world backgrounds where you give everything that is needed to play the game for the participant who needs the most, who's coming to your game. So you give them all the information that they're going to need to have a good time, and nothing more. So they can make shit up, because we're playing make-believe. Sorry for my foul language, I didn't know if we had agreed upon swearing in this situation. But does anyone feel badly about swearing in this circle? That's totally fine if they do. Okay, we're playing fucking make-believe. So give people the room to actually do that.
I guess to start by talking about character sheets at Wayfinder, kind of move into my relation to the LARP and co-creation in that space. And I think we have had, so the way that Wayfinder set up, it's a summer camp, and at each event we run a 1 to 3 contained LARP adventures we call them adventure games, generally they don't carry over from week to week. Sometimes they do, but usually it is contained. Your character exists in the space of that 3 to potentially 8 or 12 hour mark, and then that's it. And they may die during that time, you may play more than one character during that time, and so we preach a lot of being willing to give up characters and things. The stories themselves are written ahead of time by members of our staff or community, submit them, and they're selected. So there is technically like one game designer. I'm not really a game designer. I am mostly an event director and coordinator, and many other hats that I wear at the company. But with that, some people really love character sheets, some people do not. My personal interaction with that, as someone who is viewing this as building everyone's camp experience, and all of the kids, either themselves or their parents, are paying for this transformative experience of communal living and having this week and the roleplay experience itself. For me, something that I approach game writers with when they want to do character sheets, when they tell me they're doing character sheets for every single character in the game, is if you are giving a character sheet to everyone in the game, is everyone getting a character sheet with the same level of effort that goes into it? Is that something that you can actually provide? And if it is, that's great. And I'm very happy to facilitate that. If it is that and it's destroying the person, that's fine. No, it's not fine, but like, that's fine, don't do it. And then, yes, I've seen people engage in those ways. I think, kind of for us in that way, no matter what, if you give character sheets or if you don't, it's going to be co-created. Because you read the character sheet, you interpret the character how it is, and it is already that way once removed an interpretation and brought in as this separate creation that potentially the writer designed it as. With us, I think that co-creation gets, like, we are inherently co-created to yet another level because our work is split into many departments, where we have our story writer, who is the person who's written everything, and then they come and they talk to. They tell like me as director, hey Jeff, like I want to do last summer. Someone's like, we want to coat everyone's hands who's in this one group in black paint, in real black paint, and have them running around and they'll touch people with black paint. And I had like, no, that will damage this land. That is a part that we can't do. And so, and then with that, like every there's a production department, and there's a game system department, a costume department. So you get this creation split up amongst people. So while it's very easy to view one of our games and see this story writer has created this product, realistically, even before you get to all of the participants and staff members playing their characters out in those interpretations, you've had like 10 to 16 different sets of hands and perspectives going into setting up the actual physicality and limitations of this game. And so like the practical creation before the actual play is inherently co-creative for us.
And when it's done well, like it's so important to work with producer. If you have a division where you have like, well, like in film, perhaps you have like a producer and a director, a producer and a writer or a showrunner, they need to understand each other's jobs. Because of course the like the logistics or the production stuff is a design limitation that you have to work with, otherwise you're gonna end up with like ugly patches basically. How you make these design choices about the level of co-creation, it depends on a lot of things, and one of them, of course, is who your players are. So, for Inside Hamlet, that is this big multi-day event that we do. It's a Hamlet, in a sort of alternate history Hamlet set in the 1930s, and we played in the actual Castle Elsinore, which is in Denmark. And we have tickets and you should come. It's a lot of our, the age range of the participants is very big. So it's the recommended lowest age limit is 21, but then we have players all the way up to their 60s. And it means that a bunch of our players, the majority probably, are professionals with quite busy jobs. They are often parents. They don't have, like, it's not realistic for them to do a process where they have to do a lot of character design work and group building and hangouts on like Google Hangouts to talk to their team and things like that. We need to tell them that, like, we're already asking them to prep their costume, to read the play once or see the movie once if they haven't before, and to read their character sheet and show up at a specific time in another country, typically. And that's kind of all we feel that we can demand of them. And then we have designed the whole process so that everything else you need to learn to engage with this thing happens on site. And that means that we only have, then I think the most important resource always that you have as a designer is player time and player like mental capacity. And there's only so much we can do during the workshop hours that we have, and that defines what is predetermined and what is what can be created together in the moment. And making choices between those is quite important. But we also have other kinds of games where we approach it slightly differently. Because of course the other big resource is organizer time and writer time. Like you're saying, like that if you predetermine everything, it just takes forever to do it well. And even if you do it well, the participants might not know. Like they might not understand your design, especially if they come from different play cultures. So they might not actually know which parts of that beautiful written character sheet are vitally important for gameplay and which ones are just like fluff, flavor text, like beautiful flavor text, but inspiration for your character, but not actually vital to how the game will function as an interaction machine. So the way it's often been solved in the Nordic community is that we went from quite long and quite ambitious character sheets to shorter and shorter and shorter, so that, and maybe you have a highlight or maybe you have like a bullet point list that says these are the things that you actually need to, that you cannot change and that you have to bring into play for this fiction to work. The rest of it, like, negotiate with each other, for instance. Or you can make them up, and so on. And we are working with some of our vital things where we want to make very big games scale up to hundreds of people. We are working with a tool called LARP Weaver, which is a complete game changer for us in this. So then it's an online tool where for each project we define which bits in character creation are actually relevant in this particular LARP, like which qualities of the character or which networks between different characters and character groups will make this LARP work. And then the rest of the stuff we can generate by having a relatively small number of text snippets that may be about character personality or something like that, and people will answer questions. And then the machine will give them the kind of text part that will enable them the kind of play experience that they want. And the combinations, the number of possible combinations becomes astronomical after a while. So then you can, with relatively little labor, you can actually scale up to 600 players, for instance. And they will all have unique characters, which both function, like they have these character seats and certain elements that we have designed, that the game needs. But then everything else that they get, they have literally chosen and created and combined. And that's a way of like automating it where we respect their time and our time equally.
I'm going to open it up. If anybody has thoughts about co-creation that they feel like haven't been addressed, if they have questions, if they just want to veer in a different direction.
Could I ask that if you want panelists to answer a question, that you indicate that, or if you want to just like open up to a circle, you also can also indicate.
Yeah, awesome.
I think this speak to anyone. Do any of you have thoughts on ways to introduce co-creation into a group which hasn't done it much so far? Like how to introduce it into the culture? Like, oh, this might be fun. I mean, to find out whether it even does work with that group.
Is that a response?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So anytime you, in my experience, anytime you want to introduce something, introduce it in a completely different context first. So play something like Deep Forest, which is a co-creative game about, it's almost a board game. And it has nothing to do with LARP that you're usually playing, and you're not going to use it. But it's something that is inherently deeply co-creative. You literally are drawing a map and labeling places, and it trying to shift the context of a group in the middle of a culture is just really hard.
So this is also a little bit like, I mean, you can think of an organization or a play club a little bit like a workplace, for instance. And the worst thing in a workplace, especially if you work in like a big organization, is that some consultants show up and they want to like introduce new procedures. It is the worst. So the solution is quite similar to, because like you're always struggling even to do the thing, and you've only just mastered the way of doing it that it is. And the people with most power in your organization, people with the most informal power, will be the people who are best or gaining most from the old way of doing it. So they will absolutely resist any kind of change. So that already like is a problem, unless you are literally the person who's running the whole thing. If you have the most informal power, of course, then it's easier. So then you have to do the same tricks that you would if you were a business consultant, which is to say that the changes will be introduced in two ways. The one thing that is very important is that it's not a separate project. It's not like on top of your workload or like on top of all the things you already do, we are going to add this additional thing. You have to weave it into something that is already happening when you start introducing it into the actual gameplay, although I think that's completely right about practicing this game first. And the second thing is that it needs to solve a problem that people actually have. Like, you need to find something in the LARP that is currently not working that could work better in another way, and because then you can sell people at least trying a solution. If there's something that's pretty okay and you think that it might be more awesome, then there's the risk of loss is just too big.
But add to that, again, like a business consultant, running a pilot project around a thing that actually needs to happen but hasn't worked, where you identify the new strategy and say, you know, people who are excited about this new approach can try it out on this thing that we know we need that we haven't had work yet, and they will report out to the rest of the group about how the thing is going, and sort of share how the process is working for them and tune it. Because, of course, even if you introduce a concept that you really like to a group, there are assumptions you're making, I guarantee you, there are assumptions you're making about how it will work in that group and how it needs to work in that group that will come to light in the process of running a pilot. So you can pilot a co-creative process in a project group. LARP needs to have working, and have the people who are working on that tell the rest of the group, like, oh my god, this was great, except this piece that we changed, and now that's great too. Or it needs to fix it this way.
Also, lastly, I would suggest identifying the ways that participants are already doing co-creative things, and then finding ways to support and nudge that. So if your participants, if everything doesn't like feel very co-creative, if your participants are bringing in their costume though, one thing you could do is say, okay, for this game, we're adding a little bit of world context here where there's a marketplace now, and there's a cultural exchange where like trinkets have value and personal meaning and interpretation. So now everyone's making lanyards, right? And so you give them an opportunity to contribute to the world by saying, like, oh, they're already doing this, so like, let's make it more of a thing that people pay attention to. Like, oh, there's actually significance here with this part of my costuming that they bring in. That's just the example that I could think of off the top of my head, but I'm sure there are a lot of other ways. People are already doing things that you can.
Yeah, this ties into something I realized that we haven't touched on, and this is actually quite important, and that's that we talk about co-creation as though it would be like an equal thing, that when there is co-creation, people will equally co-create, and that's not how it works, actually, and it's not, and that's also about like an inclusion and justice and bravery and skills and a bunch of things that are happening there. So informal power is super important. And if you just open up for like people can create anything, what often happens is that certain people will create a bunch of things, and other people won't even feel that they're like they might think that their ideas will have no value, or that they don't know where to begin, or that if they do gambit, like they make a social play and they suggest something, and then they're shut down or ignored, and people might not be doing it on purpose, but that can be completely soul crushing, and they're just going to drop out of your LARP probably. Like that can hurt so much. So there's something to think there about, like social currencies. You have to have a good analysis of your play culture and how does that stuff work. And you can counter this with good design. And I think like here is one of those things where, for also in our organization, I feel that we can always do better, because it's quite common in Nordic LARPs that in big games in particular, it's just too time consuming to build specific backstory relationship between participants. So we say, we put everybody in a Facebook group and we say, shop around for relationships. And that means that people who know 100 people who are going to this LARP can very confidently ping people they know and say, hi, I'm looking for somebody to play my ex-lover, can you do this thing, you know, or something like that, and that's very easy for them. But we also want to include a lot of people who are their first LARP. A, they don't know anybody, so it's much harder for them to ask. B, they don't know what to ask. Like, they don't know what's a playable relationship. So we could provide much more infrastructure to help people, like, figure out, or, like, if you won't need to design a ritual, maybe give them, like, the blueprint for how to design a good ritual. You know, we put these things in, and to lower those thresholds. And we become blind to our own design skills, so that we have the privilege of being a good player as well. It means that we forget that we have learned how to do these things.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I just want to say, like, giving blueprints as opposed to, like, this is how it's going to be is a great tool. But also, yeah, I'm pretty sure that that every experienced LARPer, like, knows how to have a really good time, and first-time LARPers don't necessarily know how to do that.
And even how to roleplay, necessarily.
Or even how to roleplay, and it can be really challenging to support that and to support that with old players. One design thing I have seen that helps that is purposely putting new players with old players who can and want to and know they're supposed to support them in certain ways. And that's also really important.
Was that a direct response?
No, I was just going to reinforce what we were saying about affecting change in a culture there. And I think that the best way to do that is gradually. And that my byline that I always remind myself of is creation requires iteration. And constant iteration, and in as small steps as you can manage sometimes. And whenever you try to affect change in an existing culture that has a lot of inertia behind it, you're going to see kickback. And so, yeah, like finding an existing problem and trying to come up with a small and effective solution to it is a good way to work yourself in. Because anybody who's familiar with the Mind's Eye Society right now, they are, for the last year, in the middle of probably the worst possible way to handle cultural changes, because they've tried to make some very drastic positive shifts, but the entrenched 20-year-old player base is kicking back against it really hard, and it's been ugly.
Jeff?
Yeah, I think about kind of player culture, that if you wanted to bring more co-creation into a space, I think making sure that people view kind of the experience itself as a collaborative experience, and the more that you can get players to buy into this is the thing we're doing together, and things like that, and every decision they make kind of serves and impacts everyone else's game, the more you'll get people to buy into co-creation, because they'll see the way they're already interconnected. So we do a lot of work, even when we're just teaching our participants to play with swords for the first time, that when you die, you are like accepting this scene, building the scene with this other person, and even that death is a collaborative act, and it is building this, and you are really the focus of that scene. And so getting players to kind of see those ways that they're building this game together, and the whole thing will be experienced, and the more fun everyone is having. If you start to get people to buy in and see that, you'll start to see it kind of, that culture grow into every area of your art, with creation kind of going around it.
I was just going to add kind of to what you were describing before. One of the things we run into is the new LARPers who, they don't know to create these relationships or anything, kind of that drop in co-creation. So we've been experimenting with things online before the game, such as like online missions, where they're
improvisation.
Thank you. they're able to do that on the fly. Just it's not let's sit down and talk or answer questions, but it's really cool to just be watching these storytelling missions where all of a sudden they just come to this realization of my character can do this, and we have this relationship now, and it just kind of builds their character before they actually get into the game.
Yeah, the trust is a really important word here. So trust is, in a way, it's a currency that can counter some of that hierarchical stuff. And what you're saying is so important, because like a lot of the game design is about designing everything that happens before the runtime. Like just like a computer game will teach you to play it, like the kind of everything, all of your interactions with the participants are the tutorial. But that's also when you set like the tone and all of that stuff. And this is going to sound so manipulative, but like when people show up on location and you run a workshop, or like you write the player letter, like an email to your participants, you know, if you look at our stuff that our company makes, we use the words, like, it's always like friends and we, like, we're super careful about our pronouns, and now I don't mean individually, but it's collective pronouns. It's talking about the player group and our gratitude for people to showing up and doing, and the words together. I think if you made like a word cloud of our info emails, words like we and friend and together would be there a lot. And this is completely intentional. It's also true, like, we're not lying, we do feel these things, but it's also a very intentional piece of design to make sure that people already feel like it's a thing. And when they arrive, you know, if you play inside Hamlet and you arrive at the castle and finding the right place is a little bit hard, there's somebody there who's going to look you in the eye and say welcome and point you in the right direction and say, I'm so happy you're here. Or like, wow, awesome, you look great, like, so this is cool, like, can I help you with your bag or whatever. Like, that stuff is also built into it. And that's part of the design that allows them to do those playable things. And I think we were talking before, I can't remember now before we started, but about other kinds of play, like playfulness, encouraging a culture of playfulness is actually also a way of allowing people. So if you do like energizers, maybe not quite as complicated as what we're writing before, but those kinds of things, like you pretend that you do it because the participants need oxygen or they need to move around to be able to listen to more briefings, which they do, so again, like, it's actually true. But of course, if you're a good designer, you put an energizer in that's also going to make them trust each other more, or you ask them to move the chairs around because now we have solved the problem together, and that's actually also like trust building, as that's a trust building exercise.
And do you want to sort of shift into exploring how to lower thresholds for co-creation and roadblocks to that? Either tips and tricks. I know in some of your other panels you've talked about storyboarding and inviting people who aren't even LARPers into the co-creation process. And then also ways to co-create once already immersed in the LARP or the fantasy, not just pre-work. And ways that you can make people comfortable, tools you can give them. If anybody has thoughts on that, I think that would be super useful.
Both of us?
You guys, I'm verifying that you guys both?
Yeah.
Okay. Judd, you had your hand up before?
Yeah. Well, so I would very much agree that we have a huge focus on community as well, and it definitely plays out. I was going to say that with Christian, and this plays into the lowering of thresholds, we spent a lot of time playing with, like, you know, our Lumber Camp has been coming for years, and our teens who are very invested and have written games or have worked for us and have done this, and then also the majority of my time LARPing, probably hours-wise, has been spent playing with 8 to 12-year-olds who I like sit down with and introduce them to our like magic system that requires 3 hours to explain how to play in and teach them to fight with swords and like explain this world background to them, and then we sit down to make characters. And a lot of them are 8-year-olds who this is a very difficult process for. And so I would say that when you are, like the trick that works there, which I think would work with any one of the new to any scale, it's just a lot of encouragement. Which means that when I have a team of kids that says, all of us are named Shadow, I say, oh my God, yes, of course you are. And my name is Shadow too.
And all of our parents died.
Yeah,
all raised by wolves.
But like kids come in and you see a lot of the same tropes, and it can be very funny to see you like, this is what a new LARPer wants. I'm like, this is the idea that they have, and it can feel kind of old, but it is a new experience for them. So every time I have like a kid in my group, which I always have a kid in my group, who goes, can I be your kid? I'm like, yeah, of course. And so it ended up with one time, this is just kind of a funny story, my character that was given to me was like Captain Slaughter or something, which I had taken as a nickname, and some kid was like, oh, can I be your son? I was like, yeah, he's like, my name's Adam Slaughter. which is like, of course, I just came up with a first name. So I think that when you're bringing new LARPers in, remembering that probably the ideas that they're having that feel like cliche ideas are new and exciting, and probably were new and exciting to all of us at some point. And so to very much encourage them to play with those things and encourage them to get deeper and like to allow them to design that character and then to maybe complicate it a little, give them some nuance or interact with it in a way that gives them access to a deeper story.
So actually, very related to that, I have fallen into a pitfall of co-creation, running a
plates that are carved by the Puck Bowl style game, where I wanted to keep the barrier entry low, so I gave them very minimal information from this big, thick book, because I didn't want them to have to read it to sit down and play. And I said, if we're going to come up with these themes, and the things they came up with didn't fit, and then I was like, yes, we can all make this thing, but not that. And I'm sure I made a mistake somewhere on the line before I got to the point of saying, and not that, but I don't know what it was. Or maybe I should have just said, yes. Let's throw out that part of the book, and this is not the world we're in.
I do think that there are times where you need to assess, like you're saying, like, you're talking about the fictions you want to play in, and here are the things that you have to, and I think that, in, like, you want to introduce those exact ideas. Mm-hmm. And there are ways, I think, to kind of pair off the pieces of players' ideas while still encouraging them. Maybe my favorite character creation that a kid ever did was, this kid was a real struggle. I had them for like 3 weeks. They were the only person I ever actually had to take a sword away from and say, you can't play actual fight today. And they finally made this great character where they were like, these are my siblings, we've all joined the army. One after the other, our parents died in a fire. And they make this character that have relationships and purpose and things, and it moves to the next participant, and immediately they went, oh wait, also I'm a vampire. And I had to go, well, no, vampires don't exist in this world, let's stick to the character you made. And I think that you, if you kind of keep them to those guidelines, and encourage, like, if you focus on the positives that they have done, and say, like, well, the world moves in this direction, and kind of draw in what they have done, so like, the world moves in this direction, this parts of what you said are great, and let's build on those. I still think you need to keep, because right, you still need to keep the fiction that you want to tell central.
Your question?
I had like a comment on how to lower the threshold for doing co-creation. I think like co-creation is very much a creative process, right? And I really believe in a clear and concrete framework when doing creative processes. And I think that one of the ways of lowering the threshold for doing co-creation is making co-creation within a very strict boundaries, right? Especially when you're working with kids and teenagers, and when we do, especially when we do educational games in my company, Alamedia, we have an explicit design philosophy of less co-creation because it creates insecurity among the teens and the kind of results, and then going to a place where they don't know what to do because they don't know anything about LARPing or characters, relations, or co-creation. So kind of putting the bar in the right place is really, really important. And also tying into what Jock said about making the space safe. And I think this has also like been studied in other areas than LARP, for instance, by removing grades for students in universities. And I think that can translate into removing competition and trying to move away from gameism and winning, and more into collaboration and making it safe to do that, because you don't win or lose, you're just supposed to have a good time, kind of. I think one of the, maybe you can, since you are a teacher at the summer school, one of the things that were done by the organizer of the LARP Writer Summer School was to implement a philosophy where you're always invited back if you've been a teacher once. And that creates safety for the teachers to kind of collaborate instead of being scared of being exchanged with someone else. And that's really good for co-creating the curriculum. And it's the same thing with removing grades for students, and it's the same thing, I think, with all these other folks.
I think we're lowering the threshold. Probably the best way to actually get people to co-create and be collaborative in a way that really works is to do it in the actual space with the people through the ways that people are playing and interacting with each other. So, you know, I like talking about how, you know, we want people to contribute to their character sheet and we want people to like add things to the world. That's kind of a very sort of like literal co-creation thing, but then you brought up a great point about like some people make a lot, others won't, and there's kind of there's a social barrier to just making words for what the words are going to be. but I think that if we can find ways to trick people during the game and during the workshops to be playful with content and feel like they are adding content and creativity and being heard and other people are supporting the content and creativity. This is basically just improv rules, right? So we want people to be able to do that through the play, and that can be material to what they might be doing in the game. Like if the players need to defeat an evil lich lord, do you need to, for really young kids, give them the script with all the ingredients and how you put it together? Or can you give them the opportunity that, like, oh, now you have to actually make up this magical ritual together? And that is not someone being, and that's a type of co-creation that I think is often more valuable and practical than a type of co-creation where it's like, okay, so like now we're gonna talk about our character's history. Or now I'm going to be writing down this thing that some players are going to read and other people won't. When we get into literal, like, these are the facts of the world type of co-creation, that can be difficult because there are people coming, so for Event Horizon, there are a few people who can come into the play community from like a secrets and powers background, where what information is in the game is in those type of games is very important, that there's consistency. And that's not really true for Event Horizon LARPs. So we've had some difficulties there where it's like someone was like, oh, there's a blank spot in this world's background, like I'm gonna fill it in with this. And then another person said like, oh, but this is very important to me and I thought it was this and I was trying to create it in this way. And if everyone's very rigid around that, that can be a problem. So the less writing co-creation, the more like playing co-creation, I find is more functional.
I think this has already kind of been said, but just reiterating, I think to lower the barrier for co-creation, something that's super important is just setting expectations ahead of time. That way, I guess if there are people who are very against co-creation and really don't want that, then they'll just opt out of the activity. And you'll have people choose to participate in your activity who are interested in co-creation. So I think that's important. Going back to the idea of like blueprints, I think having templates for things is really helpful. At the summer camp we worked at, we have the camp counselors co-create the worlds and the narratives and props and things that we used, and we gave them a blank like narrative storyboard essentially that they used to fill in. And none of them had LARPed before or done any type of theater or anything like that. But to give them a sheet of paper that said, okay, for scene one, when all of your campers arrive, think about like what's the narrative, what are the props that you need, who are the characters that are going to be involved, etc. And they were able to sit down and just kind of like fill it in, you know, like a Mad Lib almost, just like fill things in. And it was really easy for them. Whereas if you just say, okay, like everybody break up into your groups and like create these worlds, then I think it's a little more abstract and difficult. But if you can give them a template or a blueprint, it's a little bit easier.
Really quickly, Jim, before you see, we have a program that we run at Wayfinder that is called WeFinder for our littlest ones, 6 to 7. And it is the most co-creation like piece that we do, where the kids are always playing whatever characters they've come up with, and we have a group of staff who just listen to what they say and then insert it into the world for them. So they meet the king, who says, I have this great trouble, you must train so that you can go through the portal and help me in my world. And the kids are like, oh yeah, there are fairies there for sure. And then Stephanie like slips out of the back of the room, and then by a window, like somebody with fairy wings runs by. So it's constantly reinforcing. And we had a child, there was a witch, and they were talking about what they were gonna do about this witch, this dangerous witch. And they were like, oh, we have to kill her. And there's one kid who was like, you can't kill a witch. Then you get a ghost witch. And none of the, this poor kid was just talked over. But a staff member heard. And so when all the kids went and they killed the witch, guess what you got? And so this little boy was like, I told you, like, whole body, like, joy, but also frustration and victory, and then got to list off the 15 items, magical items that you had to get to make the potion to banish the ghost. So in this way, this child who had tried to insert a narrative piece and then gotten, like, just kind of talked over, was rewarded. And that's not a system that is going to work with a lot of LARPs, but it was delightful to see for this little kid. Jump.
Yeah, before I get into what I'm going to say, if you have another chance to LARP with children and you get it, take it. They are so much better at it than we are. And it is, like, really amazing and heartwarming and life-affirming. What I was going to say, though, is Quinn's kind of touching on it can be very hard to break into, like, sit in a group and just immediately talk about your character's history, and that can be very nerve-wracking for experienced players as well as new players. And I think that ways that you can break out of that as soon as you can is if you're going around and saying, what's your character, there is a moment where each person is going to be put on the spot, and that is not a comfortable experience for everyone. And so, like, trying to get away from that as much as you can, or people as much development time before that as you can, so that when you're discussing it, it doesn't feel like that grind. I think a couple ways you can kind of do that or try and move towards, like, designing a ritual. If you are oftentimes I find myself cast as the captain of the guard. And so often what I'll do is actually just go and make formations, and, like, we'll go and drill and do that kind of practice and get people into the physicality of a character. And it will often do workshops where people are moving around the space and say, like, picture your character, how does your character walk? Do they lead with their shoulders? Do they lead with their knees? Kind of get people thinking about their characters in other ways than telling you that that involves life story details of your character that it may be difficult to just give something even about yourself. We also, in ways that we kind of trick our children into designing these, we sometimes, and I don't know if this would work as well in other systems, there may be ways to tweak it, though. We'll often incentivize development, where we tell our kids at day camp that if they go home and write a story about their character or draw a picture of their character and bring us that, we'll give them, like, 3 extra points or a dagger. A dagger or 3 extra points in our magic system gets you nothing. But it feels cool, and it gets them very excited, and they go and they do this, and then they have more fleshed out relationships, more fleshed out backgrounds, or often we have, here's the costume that I want, and then we can give the kid this, like, very specific tailored experience, and, like, for a lot of people, myself included, costume can be such a big part of making a character work for you. So I think if you can find ways to get them to kind of generate that material on their own, if you can find a way to, like, get people excited about doing that who may not otherwise be excited about doing that, you'll get people getting these kind of richer backdrops for their characters.
Just super good. I think that I really like that, because I think we should do everything we can, because there are some kids, right, if we're speaking on kids specifically or people in general, who don't want to co-create, and that's fine, but I think also there are some neat growth that happens, right, when we kind of push them a little bit out of their comfort zone. I think it's also important to remember that that we should also provide opportunities to opt out of co-creation. Kind of, if it's something that really, truly makes someone uncomfortable, that we say, that's okay, here's your character sheet.
Well, related to everything that, like, the previous 5 people have been saying, I think it might be helpful to just do, like, a little theory first. So we talk, the reason Anna's company is called Alibir, which means alibis, is we talk about alibi design, that the idea of the alibi in experience design is the thing that will give you permission to try a new thing without loss of face. So in participation or any kind of experience, when you do something, there's always that risk that you're going to be embarrassed or lost or confused or humiliated or any of those things that humans really, really don't like, because the whole process of being socialized into a culture, of course, is that we're being, like, schooled since birth through, like, shame and humiliation to follow norms as much as possible. So these are really difficult things that we're struggling with in our lives all the time. But that also means that this is a rule system that exists in the real world that is rules and therefore is programmable and therefore is hackable. So when you become aware of it, you can fix it. And the way that you create these alibis is that you become aware of the social spaces and the physical spaces and how they interact with each other. So this example that we always use is like if you have a party and you want people to dance, yes, you need some music, but probably also need the dance floors to be not too bright. Like it needs to be a little bit dark, because otherwise it's embarrassing to move. But then maybe at your party you also want people to talk to each other, so then you need another room where the music is not as loud and there's a bit more light so you can see people's facial expressions. And ideally it's a little crowded so that they're not too far from each other, so we get an immediate sense of false intimacy, which is why the good conversations at parties are always in the kitchen. This is how it might sound like, it's really awkward to talk to a stranger in the living room, but in the kitchen, I'm right here, so we're, you know, and we're already doing something with our hands probably. So it's much easier to do it. And you can put those things in intentionally that take away the shame and take away the social risk and take away the humiliation and permit people this alibi to try new things. And that's, and of course you need the opt-out there, but you want to design the system so that nobody will ever want to opt-out because it's completely safe to try the new thing.
We have about 20 minutes left. So I want to make sure that people are getting the questions, the burning questions that they have in their hearts answered.
We talked a lot about co-creation between designers and players. I just wonder if there's anything like general or specific y'all have for advice or experience with co-creation specifically between like fellow designers.
Who are already in your organization or who have never collaborated before?
Either one, like people that you work with regularly or people that you are like starting to work with, like business partners from other organizations, either one, if there's anything insightful you'll have on that.
I think there's a lot to say on that topic. As an artist, I've also done a lot of collaborative projects, and being able to collaborate with other people on something that you're working on is a skill that takes time and practice and trial and error to learn. And you have to be very good at listening. Go to listening class, or go to a workshop on kind of the compassionate listening. As an organizer, working with people who are like on the team or on my level or on the team like on a different like not company owner level, and also people who are in different organizations coming in, the way that I think about it is fairly practical in that I have to be very open minded. I have to be sure about what I like really value. That's like very important for me to like what hills do I like really need to die on besides the ones I just want to, because there are a lot of them, and then also to make a lot of compromises. I think running a big event with the resources that we have right now, really have to make a ton of compromises, saying like I want to do all these things, but what can I actually do now? And with people, it's like, what resources do they have? What resources do we really have? And then in the middle of the process, throughout the process, you have to be checking in and to be saying, like, do you still have those resources? Like, what absolutely needs to happen for this to be in the game? If that can't happen, like, you need to back out and your time is very, very important. And if the absolute bare minimum of what is needed to function happens, like, focusing on that and then saying, like now we can do the other things we wanted to do with it. That's very practical. Listening, know your values that you want to die on, being open-minded and making sure that you're willing to make compromises. And also just building good relationships with those people and making sure to value them like materially and socially for their time as much as you can.
Yeah, I think I have kind of two angles of answer that I have here. One from my non-LARP related day-to-day life, where I am like an MFA writing candidate and English instructor, which is where the people don't know what you mean all the time. and that often there may be a miscommunication, and that things that you feel are very clear or are very impactful may not be for other people. And so to be prepared to, like, especially in a form like this where your audience is interacting with it and playing in it, be prepared to take those critiques and those changes from other people, especially other designers who are in that. And then from my kind of more LARP-related life, recognize the areas of expertise that those other designers have, and like seek out that expertise. Like I said, we have things divided up into departments. So we have people who, I was just talking to Jay Dragon, who's here, who writes a lot of games for us, who they were saying that they'll often go to production or costume and be like, make our monsters look like whatever you want them to. Like, you know what cool monsters look like better than I do. So if you have designers that you know have kind of areas of expertise that you may not, I would say, lead into that and like get everything you can from them.
This might be controversial because, of course, making LARPs is an art form, and I believe that really passionately, and I think of making LARPs as like my artistic practice. But at the same time, I do want to make a distinction between an artistic process and a design process. So like, I think fundamentally an artistic process is about exploration and about finding things, and maybe you start with you can start anywhere your artistic process and like dig into things and test things and go looking for things to figure out how they feel, and themes that might emerge and so on. And that is something that is often quite good to do also as part of your LARP making process, but that is not how you make a LARP. Like, we are building frameworks when we make any kind of game or any kind of LARP. Not all LARPs are, I guess, technically games, certainly not at our end of the scale. But we are creating frameworks and rule systems, even though those are not about stats necessarily, they are about like cultures and social behaviors and social scripts and things like that. And that has to be goal-oriented. Like, that is a process where you're working towards, because you want very specific outcomes, so you're building something that's going to generate that outcome. And then you do it iteratively. And that might look quite a lot like artistic exploration, which is also a kind of iteration, but it isn't actually, because again, like, in the point of artistic exploration is to not know the goal, whereas the point of a design process is very much to know the goal, and you can change your mind about the goal if it turns out that you were wrong, but it's still like a direction there. And I do find it very important in processes to remember where you are. Like, are you now? Are we being artists now, or are we being designers? And if you have two people who are at different points in their process here, it's not going to work. And that ties into what we were talking about before about character writing. I think it's a massive historical mistake in our community that we talk about LARP writers, and I think it's like shameful that we call the LARP writing summer school the LARP writer summer school. That was wrong, because we don't actually teach LARP writing at all. We teach like 2 hours of LARP writing that whole week. We teach LARP design. And writing is so important, but like, a LARP that is made in a Word document is not going to be good. You make the LARP on a whiteboard or whatever your like local equivalent is, and then when you figure out what it needs, then the writing happens. And then of course many of us have the process where first I have to write and create the world or like do the things that I fall in love with, and then put that aside, then do the design, and then again like write the things that are needed for the work. But that, there's something about that where the collaboration breaks down when we don't understand what phases we are in.
Thank you. I want to share a resource. There's an academic paper that I think is valuable for people interested in collaboration by Robert Moldbank. The title of the piece is What to Do Next, The Case for Non-Predictive Strategy. Some of it's pretty dry, but he does a great job of laying out a general form of a collaborative, co-creative process for both creating shared vision and gathering collaborators and building a resource base with which to pursue that shared vision.
What was his name, sir?
Wiltbank. Is the last name, Wiltbank, and I found it again by looking up Wiltbank strategy making, and the very short summary of what he describes in great detail and makes an argument for is get a general vision of your direction, share it with some people who you think might be interested, and see what resources they're willing to commit and what constraints they want to add to the vision. And as you build a resource pool, you do that iteratively. As you build a resource pool, your vision will narrow to a specific thing, and you can simultaneously be iterating with those resources in pursuit of the vision and learning more about what it's going to take. And your resource pool hopefully will grow to the point where you can eventually reach the thing. But you want to get resources that people are willing to commit, whether you reach it or not.
A little bit to that point, I think constant check-ins with people that you are co-creating with. Are you still on the same page about what you want? Are you still on the same page about what is possible? If that's changed, how and why? And then make space for non-design hangout time so that you continue to develop trust with this person that you are making a baby LARP with, you know, like you need to know and trust your partners in that and finding space to do that. And also, when things get heated, take a break and eat some food. Like, always have snacks because your low blood sugar is going to ruin your design. Or relationship, or both. And
this is just a random thought that I had, but I think one thing too that's important in co-creation that we haven't really touched on yet is the aspect of risk. And that if people are interested in co-creating, or if we're inviting people to co-create, I think we need to be aware and let other people be aware that if they're co-creating, they're also taking a piece of that risk, I think. Because as organizers, oftentimes, we're the ones that are supposed to take the risk of everything, right? Because we're the ones facilitating and organizing. But I think as we co-create more, that risk gets spread out a little bit. So, I had a question also. I would love to hear, particularly from the Wayfinder and Event Horizon folks, about your collaboration. If there are other, I'm aware of that artistic and creative collaboration in the room. If there are other collaborations in the room, with, you know, represented in the room by people who are here, if you'd be willing to speak about, I'd love to hear about your work together as LARP co-creators.
I'll try to be quick about it. So my background in LARP is with Wayfinder Experience. I'm still an employee and staff member for Wayfinder Experience. When we wanted to do Event Horizon, we talked with you about becoming partners. So we use Wayfinder's sword system, only their sword system, for our games, and the swords are our Wayfinder style swords. They're in all of our on our website. We mention them at every event. We give a proceed of our ticket sales towards the Hero Fund, which is their like scholarship for getting kids to come to camp. And so that is a very it's a partnership, but there's not really direct collaboration. Like, you guys came to our first event, which is great. But that's been very successful because, like, I get to bring what I have learned at Wayfinder into a different context, and only, not all of it, only part of it into this other context. And we get to share resources and attention, and like sharing, like marketing sharing is really great and something that a LARP should be like upholding each other when they're, unless you like really don't believe what they're doing. And then we've also collaborated with recently a lab from Santa Cruz called the Social and Emotional Technology Lab. I'm giving a presentation on it next, but they wanted to do research on bringing in tech to LARP. And so that was a process where researchers were coming in, they had a proposal, they are like getting grant money to do some of this thing. So we started the conversation with them, and we allowed them to come into our space. We like pay materially to bring them in to allow for this research to happen. And they added something to our game and game design. It was really, really cool. So that's something that's going on, and they're interested in working with you guys next. They're really awesome. It's the Social and Emotional Technology Lab from UC Santa Cruz. They've done stuff with other LARPs before too.
And I think in opportunities like these, where a lot of people in the circle at SCON are organizers or academics or artists who are doing different stuff, it's a really good opportunity to make connections and figure out how to do that. Oh, and also, I'm working with Feiler LARP Studios to do something in October at Higher Level Game Con. We're doing a collaborative game, and I can speak to what that process has been so far at a different point, but it's cool that we have these six studios coming together to make a like two-night freeform LARP at a convention. And that's very different because everyone's now on the same level. It's not me as an organizer inviting space for the lab to come in, or it's not like a partnership at a distance, that's like everyone on the same level. So that's like a lot more labor that goes into what you're collaborating for.
It's a long email thread.
Yeah, the bigger your team is, the more you have to like work at a lot of organization.
Hundreds of emails.
It's
fine.
It's fine. So again, that question was about organizations that are collaborating together and other projects like that.
We are trying to coherent the design tradition in Denmark, and by doing that, we are training the young generation in running laws, but also design from the summer school, also learning, giving them some CR tools to design labs and writing themselves on weekends. And of course, there should be many traditions in Denmark for labs. We have 50 chapters, and there is more that is not organized under a national organization. But it's nice that in a population with 5.6 million that speaks the same language, that can talk to each other in a design language and have understanding of sharing tools, equipment, games, etc., and having the trust, because a lot of the lab chapters is up as conflicts, social conflicts between them as well. I find it quite interesting to try to pull them together and talk together.
I think it's really important to set out in any collaboration, like your understanding, the words you're going to use, the direction and the feeling that you want, and get on the same page before you go deeper than that. Because it just might not be a collaboration that works for you. And there's a lot of gains from collaborating. One of the gains that Wayfinder gets from Event Horizon is just that there is more play where people are engaging socially and like learning about each other, and like I love that. That's all I want in the world. So more play, more better.
Just to say about the getting on the same page, it's also good to remember when you have the conversation about where you decide on what your goals are, what words you're going to use, and that you're going to fail. Like, you're absolutely guaranteed to have misunderstandings that come from the fact that your procedures are different, or the way the word is used in your organization is different, or your baseline assumptions about like how something works, or what is the character, or how is labor distributed between people in an organization, or how is labor distributed or responsibility distributed between participants and LARP makers. Like all of those assumptions, the bigger the assumptions are, like the more core they are to our design traditions, the more invisible they are to us, and therefore we won't be able to verbalize them when in advance to warn somebody else. That's why it's so valuable to have things like Living Games, and that's of course what's happened in other countries as well. We have 20 years of Living Games basically, talking to each other, and butting heads and having misunderstandings and trying to collaborate and failing miserably and hating each other. Because also like these are the big things, like if somebody else doesn't even understand how to make a character sheet, they have to be an idiot. Like then they don't. Then you don't understand anything about LARP, because how can you even play when this basic thing isn't the way it has always been? And then when you realize that, oh, that's also a design choice. Like these people seem very successful to be making things in some other way. That's of course how we grow and learn, and that's how like common design language eventually will emerge. But the only way to get there is to fail. And if you can have a culture where you can say that every time we miscommunicate, we are learning, that's when we're leveling up. And it hurts, but that's the thing, that's how we learn. That's actually going to help you a lot in the work.
Thank you.
It's 3 o'clock exactly.